Welcome back to Midpoint. Veteran of the governmental, political, media relations wars, Newsmax contributor Clarence McKee is right around the desk. And we are also joined by the Director of Strategic Partnerships for NORML, the National Organization for the Reform of Marijuana Laws, Sabrina Fendrick. All right, Clarence, now you heard Sabrina before we went to break right there. Yes. She said, no loopholes.
Well, Ms. Fendrick, I invite her to take a look at the entire amendment. And she goes to definitions, talks about those debilitating diseases, which we feel people should get treatment for. AIDS and hepatitis. But you see, fine print says, or other conditions. Now that could be headache, backache, stomach ache, bad toe. That's where this, where they sneak in under the carpet and you're talking about quasi-illegalization. And a doctor, by the way, cannot give a prescription for this stuff, for pot. It's illegal. FDA won't allow it. You can't go to a pharmacy and get it. It's illegal. So what do they create under this act? Medical treatment centers, well, marijuana treatment centers, pot shops can be in any neighborhood. There's no restriction on where they can be, near school. If you go to Ms. Fenwick's home of Denver, Colorado, they have 400 pot shops in the state. They have, in Denver alone, 190 plus pot shops. There are more pot shops in Denver than McDonald's, Starbucks, or
okay, hang there. Sabrina, sneaking under the carpet, it's to you.
Well, first I would say to discuss the other component of medical issues that is included in the amendment. The Supreme Court already ruled when allowing this to be placed on the ballot that this will only be used for debilitating diseases. And when you are talking about there's no regulation for where the pot shops can be, or the treatment centers, marijuana treatment centers, it says in the amendment in Section D, it is, like I said, up to the Department of Health to determine all of those regulations. In Colorado and in other states, there are regulations about where places are zoned for treatment centers and who can get them and who can qualify and where, how that entire process works. It also includes another section where it allows the legislation to come up with laws that are consistent with the provision to further regulate what is going on.
Okay, Sabrina, I'm gonna have to stop because—
to establish a protocol.
We only have about 2 minutes and I wanna make sure we get one other point in here right now. And yes. I wanna get back to the NAACP. Sabrina, okay. I'm gonna ask you about this briefly. There are those who say, stop adjudicating, stop going after specifically young black men, you're putting too many of them in jail. It's part of the problem here. It's only a minor marijuana bust. Is that the way NORML feels, that this is also partially a race issue?
Well, if we're specifically discussing Amendment 2 and medical marijuana in Florida, first of all, the NAACP's press release about this had nothing to do with arrest and racial arrest disparities. It had to do with health concerns and the community that they represent. They are not a one-issue organization about criminal justice. They're an organization that represents and looks out for the multiple issues that are that community is dealing with, including different diseases that are specific or more prone to that community.
Okay.
So, but if we are going to go into a conversation about decriminalization and legalization, that is an entirely separate issue.
Well, and yes, exactly right. And I wanted you to go ahead and exactly what you did. You talked about the NAACP specifically talking about this one. Clarence, response to you about a minute left.
Problem is that she misstates something. This is a constitutional amendment. This is not a piece of legislation that the legislature could come back and change and tweak it. This is in the Constitution of the state of Florida. So when it talks about the Department of Health and all these things that she's discussing, fine. But the minute the department tries to change something, it's going to be a lawsuit. This is locked in stone. If you vote yes for this, it's forever. It's forever. If you vote no, come back, look again, and we'll try to get the something that can really help people who are sick.
Sabrina, 15 seconds. Go ahead. What did you say?
I would say the amendment explicitly says that it's up to the Department of Health to create the rules. Nobody's going to sue. It's in the amendment. So when that passes, that we Section D and Section E, that's all I have to say, is this is the reason that it is written the way it is so that it can be placed in the lawmakers and the government officials' hands to create a policy that they think will best serve the public and
okay.
the patient.
You're misreading the law, Ms. Fendrick.
Okay, unfortunately, we are all out of time. We got to do this again. The clock is all against us. Sabrina Fendrick, thank you so much for your comments. Clarence, thank you so much as well. We will be back. We will do this again. We're covering this law right up until the time it goes into effect and a whole lot more.
She's wrong.
Because, okay. Well, wait a minute. She's wrong. Why?
Because it's locked into the Constitution. You can't come back and have the legislature tweak an amendment to the Constitution. The people have to change an amendment to the Constitution by 60% of the vote. That's the point.
Nothing in this section shall limit the legislature from enacting laws consistent with this provision.
Okay, there we go. I'll tell you what, this is open to so many different interpretations here, but I do understand that we're going to cover this a whole lot more as we get down to it, because believe me, this discourse is going to happen, yes or no, no matter
exactly.
What the vote is.
It's what consistent means, is it?
Sabrina Fendrick, thank you so much. We'll talk again soon.
Thanks for having me.
All right, Clarence McKee,
good.
Always a pleasure to see
great.
You, my friend. Thank you good. So much. Later thank on this you. Hour, inside a Taliban stronghold and one man's armored answer to fighting ISIS. After the break, going after those who hide behind the unbreakable wall of their smartphones. And this is what has law enforcement concerned. That and a whole lot more right here on Midpoint, where we question everything.